So as you know, we've been exploring the topic of refuge, that which gives us a sense of sanctuary, comfort, support, refueling, inspiration in the long and rocky and sometimes stormy road of life. Refuges. In the Buddhist tradition, three classic refuges are the teacher, the teachings, and the community of the taught, which is my modern way of describing the refuges of Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha. And I am going to be relating some of those classic refuges to more modern neuropsychologically informed ways of looking for ways of being inside ourselves that we can draw upon and rest in no matter how crazy it gets all around us. So, to that point, one way that people understand the first classic refuge in Buddhism, the refuge of the Buddha, as I take the input and turn up the gain on my microphone a little bit, but if you're having sound difficulties, probably it's happening at your end. So just turn up the volume maybe or bang on your computer. Anyway, so one way of understanding the teacher is to think of the teacher within. And the word Buddha comes from the root buddho, which is to know, to be aware. And toward the end of the meditation, we were moving into, and you may have gotten there already, that sense of inner knowing, inner awareness that is completely stable. And because it's stable, it's still, right? The screen on the computer is stable. Movement goes through it, but the screen itself is still. In much the same way, awareness is like that kind of screen that is still as things move through it. In that sense of inner knowing, which can give us a great sense of stillness and tranquility and calm, there might even be a sense of a one who knows. This gets kind of mysterious, sort of above my pay grade, but you might have had the sense as you were resting there in the meditation of being identified with or rested in a quality of beingness that felt utterly undisturbed. With practice, we can increasingly have a sense of that. And even if it's not in the foreground of our consciousness, because we're driving in rush hour traffic or scrambling to do the dishes while also preparing for dinner or vice versa, in the back of our minds, in our mood, truly, can be that growing quality of an underlying knowingness that we can return to when it gets nutty around us. That's a very deep and wonderful thing. I want to flag it because, having flagged it, I'm now going to get a lot more down to earth and practical when we explore the neurobiology of deep calm. So, in terms of our body's machinery, there are certain things that can help to support an experience of calm and calm strength, a kind of underlying inner peace, which gives us a very powerful basis for resilience as we deal with stressful, turbulent challenges, such as this time in which we're grappling, certainly around the world and in my own country, America, we're grappling with quite serious problems of different kinds. No matter what it is that we want to do outside us, if we can act from a secure base, to use the language of attachment theory and psychology, if we can act from a stable platform of our own inner calm, we're much more likely to be effective, as well as we're much more likely to preserve some basic well-being inside ourselves along the way. So I want to talk about several keys that are authentic, that are not about numbing, that are authentic as the basis for establishing a calmer, more stable, more relaxed, more easeful, more rested, even more tranquil, way of experiencing the core of yourself, even as you're outwardly active and busy. And then I want to open it up for questions that, may have come in from other people, in the chat. You can chat me privately if you want, or you can chat more publicly so other people can see your question. And then as we go along, I'll try to call on at least one person to get your voice in the room. Okay? So one fundamental basis for bodily calm is the engagement of what's called the parasympathetic branch of the autonomic nervous system. This is the most ancient branch of the autonomic nervous system, which is an aspect of the nervous system that keeps us on an even keel and keeps our other non-human animal cousins as well on an even keel. The parasympathetic branch of the nervous system is so ancient that we share it, or essentially analogs to it, homologs to it, with lizards and crocodiles and frogs. So this is a part of our body that slows down the heart rate and helps us relax. So I want to mention one thing in particular that I think is a real kind of cool little trick noted in the research literature, which is to exhale slowly. You might want to try it right now. Take one or more breaths in which maybe you count internally, and your exhalations are longer than your inhalations. So for example, inhaling 2, 3, exhaling 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Just that. Calming, slowing, soothing, stabilizing. A second thing that we can do that really supports calm is to get a sense of things as a whole. It's really quite remarkable. Recent research, and I talk about it in my book, Neurodharma, and there are plenty of references for it, shows that when we get a sense of things as a whole, that naturally reduces kind of frenetic interactivity that's preoccupied with the future or the past or ourselves. Wow. So right here, for example, you can get a sense of breathing while feeling your chest as a whole. And so if you want a 2-for-1, take one or more breaths in which you are aware of, you feel, you're experiencing your chest as a whole, while deliberately extending the exhalation. So let's try to do that together. And one thing I love about these methods, by the way, is that you can do them covertly, pretty much. Other people in a business meeting or sitting around the table or when your partner is like telling you how to be a better person, et cetera, et cetera. I try not to do too much of that with my wife. When that's happening, just inside yourself, you're like, whoa. You're all Zen, whoop, Jedi, Yoda, whatever. So let's try it. Taking a breath while feeling your chest as a whole, and then exhaling slowly while continuing to feel your chest as a whole. Here we go. I'll do it with you. Wow. Pretty cool, huh? So, two suggestions already, very practical. Extend the exhalation. The other one, get a sense of things as a whole. Could be your chest as a whole, could be the room as a whole, could be a situation as a whole, you know, big picture, bird's eye view, anything like that will tend to promote a sense of calm. Now, there are other methods for promoting calm, and I definitely want to give a shout out here to the work of Herbert Benson, one of the early researchers on the mind-body connection, and who's done tremendous research that relates to what he calls the relaxation response. You might have your own methods, visualizing fluffy white clouds, recalling a time in a, you know, you were at the seashore or next to a beautiful mountain pond. Also, I think it's important to appreciate that we can continue to be vigilant and aware and not let people take advantage of us and not, you know, and be aware of threats while also relaxing the body. And here I want to also appreciate, you know, someone I taught a retreat with, Leslie Booker, who's typically known as Booker, who points out that sometimes, especially in childhood, abuse of different kinds can begin with the advice to relax. And so for some people, the instruction to relax, even if it's given to oneself, is actually disturbing. So it's really fine, and it's okay, it's appropriate to find other ways in, like a sense of easing, or as Booker, who's quite very trained in trauma work, has pointed out, that if we just take a moment to orient and remind ourselves of where we are and that we're okay, physically okay right here, it's easier, it can be easier to open into a sense of easing and calming in the body. So, extending the exhalation, awareness of things as a whole, reminding yourself that you can calm, you can ease, you can relax while still being aware of your surround and still protecting yourself. So that's another very useful piece of this here. And then a fourth tip goes to the ways in which, as prey animals, we are very vulnerable to fear. You may have heard me talk about this. Basically, in the wild, and we are biological, right? We are biological. We are animals, human animals, as my friend Daniel Ellenberg puts it. In the wild, we were prey. We were eaten by predators, you know, frequently. And in that context, a person, one of our ancestors, could make two kinds of mistakes. One kind is to think that there's a tiger in the bushes about to pounce or some other threat, but in fact, the coast is clear. There really is no threat. The other mistake is to conclude that everything's fine, but actually, something is about to get you, truly. The cost of the first mistake is needless anxiety, but the cost of the second mistake could be mortal. And no more mistakes forever. So we're designed to have what I call paper tiger paranoia. We're designed to be generically uneasy, apprehensive, even when nothing's really wrong. And this is useful if you're working in a combat zone or living back in Jurassic Park or the Stone Age or during the Game of Thrones. It could be useful to have that meaningless anxiety always trickling through you, if not rushing through you, to keep you on your toes. But much of the time, for most people these days, that kind of needless anxiety creates lots and lots and lots of unnecessary suffering. And so one thing that's very helpful is to explore fear in all its subtle forms, to become extremely mindful of fear. Subtleties of apprehensiveness, subtleties of bracing and guarding. Yeah, you can be aware of it right now. We do it habitually. We hardly even notice it till we bring our attention to it. How are you bracing yourself around other people? Yeah. How are you guarding around other people? How do you feel like you need to be armored unnecessarily around other people? It was really interesting to try to walk across a room without any anxiety. And back in the day when there were a lot of chronic warnings that, you know, at all times it was threat level orange, I found myself really exploring what it was like to walk through airports with my eyes wide open, you know, being aware of anything that might be suspicious. I never saw anything suspicious, and I traveled a lot. But, you know, with my body soft, you know, open. It's like, I think about the Buddha's advice that one is wise, not just because you can spout off a bunch of, you know, a bunch of sayings, but one is truly wise who is, has three qualities, who, one who is peaceable, friendly, and fearless. So as I tried to walk through the airport, you know, in that peaceable, friendly, and fearless way, and it wasn't always easy. You know, we take our cues from other people. We get, you know, anxious. We get anxious about not being anxious. That's why it's important to realize you can, you know, keep your guard up and if need be, and you can certainly be vigilant if need be, while not feeling internally anxious inside. So it's very useful to monitor fear and unnecessary fear and to take a stand inside yourself that you've had it with feeling unnecessarily threatened, right? We can be cautious, we can be vigilant, we can deal with things without taking on board a feeling of being threatened. And it feels so good to release unnecessary threatenedness. It feels great to do that. Most people are walking around feeling much more anxious than they truly need to be. A few people should be more anxious than they really are. Like sometimes young people who underestimate the actual risks of doing risky things, you know, stupid stuff, right? But for most people, I think we're unnecessarily anxious. I think that's certainly true for me. And it's just remarkable and joyful to, in really granular ways, washing the dishes, walking across a room, brushing your teeth, talking with someone, getting on a Zoom call like this, dealing with technology, exploring that again and again and again with a serenity inside that's untroubled by fear. So that is my fourth suggestion. Extending, you know, in addition to my original suggestion of getting in touch with that inner knower, that place deep, deep, deep inside of awareness, just pure awareness that is very stable and still. I've also talked about extending the exhalation, being aware of things as a whole, you know, knowing that you can be aware and strong while still feeling calm inside, and now being mindful of needless anxiety and really letting it go. And that mindfulness of needless anxiety, number four, is really served by recognizing in the present when you're basically all right now. Maybe you're not all right in certain moments, but there you are, you're talking with your partner and there's an argument, or you see the political news and you just go, oy, you know, whatever the future may hold, whatever the past has been, when in the present, you're basically all right now, why not feel it? It's kind of joyful to just go, oh, to feel reassured, to feel comforted. Oh, I can let it go. Oh, that feels really, really pretty great. So I'm going to explore in other evenings ways of grappling with anger, which is another major disturbance of our inner peace. And I'm also going to explore ways to release drivenness, which I know well, and to realize that you can still, you know, dream big dreams and pursue your goals without paying the price of the pressure, the inner pressure of drivenness. But tonight I want to, you know, just kind of let it settle. The meditation on tranquility that we did, the sense of abiding increasingly as awareness, or having a sense of a witness inside, or a witnessing, more exactly, a witnessing process inside that is itself undisturbed and undisturbable because it's stable. There's a stability of that stillness deep inside yourself. And also, I want to leave it with these four sort of practical tips about letting go of the fear that agitates us and disturbs our peace of mind and our inner peace altogether. If you have specific questions or comments, please put them in the chat. That's a very efficient way for me to respond to them, including specific situations, such as, maybe rationally that there's no reason for fear, but based on your history, perhaps a trauma history, the body is still fearful, understandably, or what to do with situations where people really are threatening and you need to set boundaries with them. I can happily talk about that. That actually is a way for me, super briefly, just to mention that, as you may have seen in my contributions to the chat, I'm teaching a relationship workshop this weekend on Saturday and Sunday. It'll be live. And if you want to learn more about it, you can look in the chat. There's a link you can click. Or you can go to my own personal website, rickhanson.net, and see about the relationship workshop there. Basically, it's a hyper-practical, super-focused workshop on very specific ways of being inside yourself, traits to develop over time, and skills with other people that are kind of grounded in my long history as a couples counselor and equally long, actually longer history as a husband and father. So anyway, you can check that out. Okay, so I want to open it up for questions or comments so far. And I'm going to take a little bit of a moment here just to see what's come in. Da-da-da. And... Okay, good. So I'm just kind of scanning here. Great. Okay, so I'm going to respond to a private question that came in where the person basically says, essentially, what's the relationship between fear and anger? In other words, this is a person, I'm going to edit slightly. If you private chat me, I won't say your name and I'll edit your question a little bit so it's not identifying. So what do we do with people who are actually doing risky things, like people these days in a time of plague who are just refusing to wear masks or adhere to just very kind of standard public health recommendations? Right, so those other people are actually threatening. They're real tigers. What do we do about that? And to be really clear, anxiety is a signal. It's designed to be a signal, and there's a place for fear. Fear is not bad. There's a place for fear. The question, of course, though, with fear in all its forms, is how much is signal, and how much is noise. For example. Often, if the body is disturbed for some reason, you ate something funny, your body's disturbed for some reason, or there's some inflammatory process in it for any reason, maybe there's physical pain in the body. Well, understandably, the body just starts generating alarm signals that rise up into the brain, which then starts to look around for the source of that, often outside ourselves. So there's this underlying kind of primal anxiety based on a primary issue in the body, but it doesn't mean that something outside you is necessarily threatening. That's an example of anxiety that's noise, but not signal. And it's really helpful to realize and to filter what's useful information in the anxiety, and also what's useful information in the anger. Anger, too, is a signal. Anger is energizing. There's nothing wrong with it. It's, evolved to serve purposes for us. It tells us things. We want to listen to what it has to say. But after we get the message, why not hang up the phone? Why keep paying the price of those negative emotions, which include wear and tear on the body? Because negative emotions like fear and anger are stressful. People can become quite attached to being fearful and angry almost as a way of life, like they don't know how else to be. Or they're afraid that, if you take my fear from me or my anger from me, things will fall apart. Well, that's why it's important to not take fear or anger from people and respect their defense system. to put it technically, but it also really highlights the need to find other vehicles. There are other ways to recognize threats and to mobilize coping responses to them, which might be withdrawal, fleeing, or it might be some kind of confrontation, fighting in the loosest nonviolent sense. There are other ways to mobilize coping responses than on the basis of fear or anger. Very fundamental. And you might think to yourself, yada, 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 Rick, I've heard this a million times before, including at least 1,000 times from you. Okay. All right. And still, I've heard it. I've heard it from me. And still, something happens. Your partner says this, or you look out the window and you see that, or you check, you know, the news and, or you get an email. Really interesting to explore what it's like to move through life while experiencing no useless fear or anger. Experience it when it's useful. Experience it when it's informative, but nothing more. Wow, what would that be like? So specifically about dealing with people or, you know, what to do with people, and I certainly encounter them who are not operating in a way that protects you if they're infected with the coronavirus at the time, because that's always the question. If that other person is infected, are they doing what's necessary and are you doing what's necessary so you don't get it too? And then maybe pass it on to somebody else. You don't know if they're infected or not, usually. And you don't know. So to me, and it's public health advice, what's prudent is to act as if they could be infected and make sure that you still, by your own estimation, are safe and prudent. So that's the question, right? What do we do in that larger context? And I find that one of the very important things is to cope, is to take action and not feel immobilized. When we feel immobilized, it's the worst of all worlds. We feel immobilized or kind of vibrating with frustrated fear and anger. Brrr. It's like being in a closed vessel with ping pong balls or, you know, golf balls flying around. Not good. Action is really appropriate. And then after that, shed. Lay it down as best you can again and again and again. That needless stress and tension and fear and anger. That's really important. So I want to do a little thing here with my own image. Great. Okay, good. So, great. All right. So far? So good? Great. It's been really useful for me to be passionate about not being scared or irritated. You might really consider that as a practice and to really get excited about it. Wow, and interested in it. How to move through life without feeling afraid or angry. Wow, authentically, not based on numbing yourself, but authentically. Okay, some more questions here. And I'm gonna move through these much more rapidly. All right. What do I suggest for the physiological adrenaline cortisol feeling in the body? Great question. So it's natural, especially if we're sensitized by our history, for us to get that jolt of stress hormones if we're frightened or angry. And then a couple things to do. One is to move, because our ancestors moved a lot. Hunter-gatherers typically on average walk around 6 to 8 miles a day. They were burning off their cortisol. They were metabolizing it through physical activity. But these days, often we feel, you know, anxious and irritated and related feelings sometimes of frustration, but we're not moving. We're stuck at a desk or we're in a small space. And so it's important to try to metabolize cortisol and clear stress hormones through bodily activity if you possibly can. A second key is to turn toward a wholesome pleasure as soon as you can. Maybe it's just the relaxation of exhaling. Maybe it's just a cup of tea or a drink of water, something beautiful, see the flowers outside your window, something. Pleasure also helps to clear natural opioids that come with pleasure tend to help to clear stress hormones. And another one that's a quick fix, if you will, is the feeling of heartfeltness, whether it's caring flowing out or caring flowing in. That's a very practical way to immediately clear fear and anger. Okay, moving along here. I see other people are offering suggestions. That's great. Okay, so this is a comment. This is from someone about meditation. Two questions. Uncertain what to focus on, and also could feel a sense of aching, fear, and yearning in the heart and chest when becoming aware of the body, I'm assuming. In other words, feeling both an aversion to being in the body and a longing, a yearning to bring love in. Well, right off the top, the person who's saying that, you're very self-aware. That's a great sign. So stick with this. And also you're bringing something that's very important, which is a classic thing to focus on in meditation are body sensations. The Buddha offered all kinds of ways to do that. And in the Four Foundations of Mindfulness, his basic guide to practice, which could be called the Four Establishments of Mindfulness, or where do we establish mindfulness? The first of these was establishing mindfulness of the body. And we could even say an embodied mindfulness in general. On the other hand, when we bring awareness to the body, that can feel kind of alarming for all kinds of reasons. Maybe based on health issues, maybe based on a history of trauma in which the body was traumatized, or there is an embedded memory of the trauma in the body that starts to surface when we become aware of the body. So it's really okay to adapt anybody's instructions or suggestions for meditation, including my own, to find alternative, you know, objects of awareness, such as a sound or a feeling, you know, a feeling like gratitude. Second, with regard to the body, if you can do it, I myself have found that kind of like a 3-for-1 or 4-for-1 optic of awareness is the internal sensations of breathing. They bring me into body sensations, which are always available, which calm inner speech. Awareness of the internal sensations engages the insula, a part of the brain that kind of takes a person out of rumination and the default mode network. Also, the internal sensations of the body as a whole gives me that sense of the body as a whole. And also, 4-for-1, it's a 4-for-1 practice, awareness, you know, using internal sensations of the body as an object of meditation. When you do that as well, you get the reassuring message again and again and again that you're basically all right now. There's enough air to breathe. The heart is beating, the internal organs are still working, all is basically well. So I use that myself, but you're very welcome to use other objects of meditation, and teachers throughout history, outside the Buddhist tradition and inside the Buddhist tradition, and in secular traditions have pointed out other objects of meditation. Also, this ambivalence you're talking about, right? That when you get in touch with your body, there can be an aching, longing, and also a sweetness in it, and something that's important to acknowledge. Both of those things can be certainly true. And this speaks to a very general, critically important skill, which is to be able to differentiate the elements of our experience. So there's a kind of granularity to them. We know what we feel in different aspects of what we feel. We're aware of our thoughts and we're aware of our feelings. We're aware of liking and not liking, both at the same time, right? What we like about another person, what we don't like about that other person. Being aware of these things, and in particular, it's really important to be able to feel something like that aching in the heart related to old feelings of loss or unfulfilled love or unreturned love. To feel that, to accept it, to be with it, and then also be aware of perhaps some sweetness in your own longing to give love, and perhaps an awareness of the love in you that wants to be expressed and how good that is. And then what can start to happen is you start shifting the investment of attention from this over here to this over here, where you become increasingly rested in what feels wholesome. Or as someone pointed out, related to something I think I said recently, where do you dwell? You can shift your dwelling. So you can shift your dwelling place away from that, let's say, ache in the heart. Not that there's anything wrong with it, but once you know what it is, does it have additional value? Or might there be more value for you in dwelling, in shifting in to something that feels better and more uplifting and more comforting and more reassuring about who you deeply are and your own deepest, truest nature, as in this example, someone who is at bottom fundamentally loving. Okay. Okay, good. So I want to see if there's one more kind of, oh, wow, lots more. Great. And then I want to open it up to somebody. So let's see here. And I saw, I'm reading Barbara's comment, which I think is really important to speak to. Okay, you might want to read Barbara's question in the chat. I'm going to read it out loud and then see if there's someone who wants to speak up in the group, okay? It's really good, really complex here. So Barbara writes, I am in low-income housing situation, which is authoritarian in nature. In conflict with the property manager, I was issued a warning risking tenancy based mostly on inaccurate and exaggerated claims. I'm assuming from the other side, while Barbara also acknowledges, I could have been much wiser in my words. I'm aware, however, that in this context, management is often asserting their power inappropriately when they in fact feel readily threatened, mostly in terms of ego and internal fear. In other words, they are vulnerable to feeling needlessly threatened. Since this will continue, how do I soften my edges so that I can live in this situation with some measure of equanimity? There's so much about this. So there's lots I don't know. I myself have been in situations where I was quite threatened, but I had to stay in them and figure out how to manage it, including in situations in which there was a lot of injustice. But if I were confrontational about that injustice, that would actually create more risks for myself. I'm not in that kind of situation currently, but I can relate. So I'll offer a few kind of things that help me. One is, of course, the more we're threatened externally and the more we're challenged externally, the more important it is to just raise our game. Support ourselves from the inside out, you know, tighten up your program for yourself, eat a little better, try to sleep a little better, you know, take a bath, you know, walk the dog, look out the window, just whatever it is that kind of builds you up, that protects you, turn to friends, turn to inspiration, you know, watch cat videos on YouTube. What helps you? Really important. Calm and center. Feed your own roots. You got to be strong. You're being challenged here. Second, be unassailable, impeccable, faultless. Get off their radar. Don't give them anything to pick at. So minimizing intersections between you and them gets you off the battlefield, gets you off their radar, and removing any pretext whereby they could take issue with you. And there's a kind of refuge that we can take when we know that we got through each day in a way that truly was blameless. And there's no legitimate basis for someone to find fault with you. Yeah, people can make up all kinds of stuff, but at least actually There was nothing they could take issue with in your words and deeds. Whatever your thoughts may be, deep down inside yourself, words and deeds, if they were being played in a court of law or some equivalent, nothing to find fault with. That's really useful. Another is, as appropriate, to acknowledge error. There are people who are fairly rare, who are malevolent, narcissistic sociopaths. They do exist, but they're rare. Most of the people we're dealing with are thoughtless. Most of the people that we're having trouble with, often, they're just kind of thoughtless, they're careless, we don't really matter, they're not very kind, okay. But fundamentally, they're human. And sometimes it actually can mend a bridge for us to say, I apologize for that. I did this and that, and I apologize, and I won't do it again, period. And I'm not going to try to prove that to you, but I will demonstrate, actually, that I will just never do that again. So that actually can mend fences sometimes with other people. The last thing I'll just say about this, in my own experience of these kind of situations, is to find that middle place where you really recognize, if you are, being relatively powerless, or there are certain stakes in play that you have to protect. For example, maybe you have to protect your housing situation, and you just eat a lot of words. You just deal with it. And for me, it's given me some kind of comfort in terms of common humanity to realize all kinds of people throughout history who've just had to get through. And they found a way. And I think to myself, if they could find a way, I can find a way. And what can give oneself a comfort is to redefine the situation into a game that you can win at yourself. So, if you're trying to play the game of, like you would with someone with whom you have equal power, you can't win that game because they have more power than you. But if your game is to get off their radar and to hold on to your housing situation and to disentangle yourself from the conflict and live well each day in your own sphere, no matter what they do, woof, that's a game you can probably win at. Okay. I want to see if anybody has a question or comment. Want to raise your hand? I'm just going to scroll through. Anybody have something to say that's related to what I'm talking about here and is succinct? Anybody have a question or comment? I saw somebody waving a hand. I'll tend to call on people I haven't called on before. I saw someone who had two questions earlier, but I'm not seeing a hand raised. Anybody want to say anything in our last minute? No? No? You okay? All right. Okay. I see Jack Zaffos. Can you unmute yourself, Jack, or do I need to do a thing here?
I think I got it.
Great. You're good.
Okay. Sometimes when I, when I'm sitting and I'm meditating, sometimes old feelings come up where I've been disappointed.
Yeah.
Just bad situations with, things that I perceive as bad situations with people where I felt, the relationship didn't end that well and what have you. And these will come up. And is there anything, what technique could I use to work with that?
So this is situations where people disappointed you. You felt disappointed?
Yeah.
Well, I think it's wonderful that you're highlighting this. I think disappointment, like envy and a few other things, is a highly underrated kind of suffering, right? And so I'll just kind of offer a couple of things. One is to draw on the teaching, the kind of clever play on words from Stephen Gaskin, who taught the Monday night class in San Francisco back in the 60s and co-founded the farm in Tennessee, this commune and so forth. He said, if you don't want to get disappointed, don't get appointed to a reality in the first place. In other words, what sets us up for disappointment sometimes are our expectations of others, and they get disappointed on the one hand. On the other hand, it's natural that we do expect things from others. We're social mammals. We should expect things from others, and we should be someone who others can expect things from. And the truth is, many people, honestly, you know, Jack, in my own personal experience, I don't know if this is going to be dharmically correct. I have found that a lot of people, when push comes to shove, are disappointing. They just are. They won't do the hard thing. They won't do the right thing if it's hard. They won't stick up for you. They won't come through. They won't acknowledge fault. They'll casually be unethical. They kind of blow your mind sometimes. You know, you would say to yourself, wow, I so did not see that coming. People who could be very close. I mean, we all probably know stories. I've lived some of those stories, and I certainly know other stories where people that are really close to us suddenly turn on us or abandon us or just cut off all contact, right? And they will not repair. So that can certainly happen, right? I think that's really, really, really true. And I've had to deal with that, you know, certainly myself. So a few suggestions, and I'll finish pretty close on time. One is to feel the feelings and the mourning and the grieving of it, you know, to just feel it. Ouch, ouch. Second, for myself at least, I never get free of the disappointment unless I kind of scrub it for whatever is maximum reasonable on my responsibility, whatever my part was. And it sometimes is zero. But what helps me rest in the refuge of knowing that I really was blameless here, and wow, this was like a drunk driver hitting someone walking in a crosswalk, you know, is a willingness. What enables that kind of clarity and moral clarity on your own side, and you know, is to go, you know, what role, even a very small role, totally out of proportion to their bad behavior, did I have any part in this? You know, and to really name it and own it and claim it. That helps us weirdly become free of the disappointment, I found. And then last, to have compassion for the other person, not to let them off the hook morally, not to give them a pass, not necessarily to move into forgiveness. But I find that when I have compassion for other people who've wronged me, who've mistreated me, or others I care about, I feel less upset by them. And in a weird kind of way, sometimes clearer and stronger about what I'm going to do about it, right? So grieving, mourning, feeling the feelings. Second, taking responsibility for whatever part, if any, is your own, and having compassion for them, that part. And then last, I think, to turn toward what is not disappointing, right? To turn toward the people who are supportive, who are trustworthy, who, you know, you can count on. Maybe you can count on them only inside a kind of compartment, but at least inside that compartment, they're not disappointing. And then with those people, more and more, that's where you dwell. That's where you dwell. You know, maybe when you think about those other people or that other person, you still wince late at night when you're going to bed, and, you know, and just, but over time you realize there's nothing more there. There's no cheese down that tunnel. I'll never get satisfaction. It'll never be healed. It'll never be corrected. Oof. And then you move on, you know, and you turn toward other people that are going to be more supportive. You know, do you know the parable of, it's the true story in Buddhism, very briefly, a woman had lost her child, and she carried her baby. She was out of her mind with grief through the village and walking around and trying to find someone who could bring her baby back to life. And she came to the Buddha and said, "You are a noble, enlightened being. Can you bring my baby back to life?" And he understood her. He could see her grief. And he said, "Well, I can make a medicine from mustard seeds that come from homes that have never known death." You know that story? Yeah. And so she wanders around trying to find homes that have never known death, and she cannot find one. And in a funny kind of way, you know, who among us has not known disappointment, you know, including grievous, serious disappointment? You know, to be kind of blunt, I look around at the world these days, and these days it's such a deep teaching, you know, that history teaches us, the way I put it, and I'm going to use a swear word here. History teaches us two things, I think, that people can be shitty and people can be noble. Choose noble. And that's another thing, too. Don't be disappointing oneself. And in a funny kind of way, as we are not disappointing ourselves, as we just choose noble, we become less burdened and afflicted and preoccupied by all those other things. Great. Thank you very much, Jack. And I've gone over again on time. Oops! Yet again, I've been disappointing. I went long. Sorry about that. I'm going to wrap it up now. I'm going to just encourage all of us. I'm going to unpin your, or I'm going to unspotlight you, Jack, if I can, which I don't know how to. So anyway, and let's just sit together for a few breaths here, okay? Letting it sink in. Choose noble.